Welcome, everyone. My name is Farah Kotadia, Acting Program Director at AMSSA. We are coming to you live from the AMSSA offices in Vancouver. Thank you for joining us for today's e-symposium entitled Using Physical and Social Activities as Opportunities for Newcomer Integration. We would like to thank Immigration, Refugees, and Citizenship Canada for funding this event today. AMSSA is a provincial association of organizations focused on immigrant settlement, integration, and language, as well as diversity and inclusion. We are contracted by IRCC to support a broad range of immigrant and language service providers and stakeholders in BC. I'd like to provide you with a brief overview of today's event. With me in the room are four experts on this topic, with each individual having expertise in a particular aspect. The panelists are Adrian Bale, Program Facilitator and Coordinator with Immigrant Services of the YMCA of Greater Vancouver, Augusta Avram, Burnaby Community and Continuing Education, Burnaby School District 41, Kat Kiraton, Course Instructor, UBC School of Kinesiology and Engagement Strategist, UBC Community Engagement, and Vivi Wong, Director of Youth Services, Collingwood Neighborhood House. The panelists will be introducing themselves in more detail shortly. We will be hearing two case study presentations today. The first case study will be presented by Jacqueline Bernier, Smithers Community Services Association, who will be joining us via phone from Smithers to present on the Friday Games Night that was organized last summer in the community. The second case study will be presented by Sabina Ziegler instead of Michelle Redfern, Cowichan Intercultural Society, who will be joining us in person, actually. Okay. I would now like to welcome the panelists who are here with us today and ask them to introduce themselves.
Hi there, and good morning, everyone. I'd just like to start by saying thank you to AMSSA and Farah and Sabrina for inviting me to be part of this great panel and for putting on the event on such an interesting topic. As Farah mentioned, my name's Adrian and I work with the YMCA. The YMCA is a charity committed to helping strengthen the foundations of community by helping children and families thrive, promoting healthy living, and fostering belonging and connection. Both of the programs that I'm going to talk to you about today are also in line with those goals. The first program is called Canadian Fitness Connection, and the second program is our social and educational events, both of which run under Immigrant Services at the YMCA. The first program, the Canadian Fitness Connection, is currently funded under IRCC, as is the social and educational events. The Canadian Fitness Connection program is delivered at the Robert Lee YMCA, the Langara YMCA in Vancouver, and the Chilliwack Family YMCA. This program is a 12-week program which helps immigrants to connect and learn about Canadian culture through fitness and sport while developing intercultural connections, friendships, and their language skills. In the program, participants meet for 3 hours every week to take part in an hour group fitness session, followed by 30 minutes of socializing with a healthy snack, which participants take turn bringing, and then an hour and a half workshop on a topic related to newcomer life. The second program, the social and educational events, which have been running for around 10 years at the YMCA, currently take place in Burnaby, Vancouver, and Chilliwack. Although topics vary and can be anything from Aboriginal art and culture walks to Halloween parties to panels on starting a small business, there are always carefully considered learning outcomes in each of these events. Some of those outcomes include enabling stronger connections amongst participants, allowing for deeper understanding of key aspects of Canadian culture, developing communication skills, and assisting participants to feel connected with the community. Both of these programs rely heavily on volunteers, The Social and Educational Events Committee has some volunteers who've been involved with the program for up to 10 years. Just briefly about myself, my educational background is in physical activity studies, as well as I'm a certified TESOL instructor. I've been with the YMCA running these programs for about 2 years, and before that I was traveling and teaching abroad, which gave me a sense of how hard it can be living in another country and a deeper appreciation for being Canadian. Thanks, and I'll pass it over to Augusta.
Thank you. Hello everyone, my name is Augusta and I'm a LINC instructor with Burnaby School District 41. It's a real pleasure to be here and take part in an event that promotes newcomers' integration into Canadian society, a topic that is very close to my heart. At present, I teach a blended LINC 6 class at Windsor Neighborhood Learning Center, next to the building where I started my own newcomer journey in Canada a bit over 20 years ago as a volunteer ESL teacher. As a LINC instructor, I'm responsible for the development of curriculum and the delivery of instruction that are both aligned with CLB, that is the Canadian Language Benchmarks, which set the national standard in adult ESL programs. In order to help my students be successful and reach their goals, I also pursue collaborations with community groups, such as YMCA, and organizations that support newcomers' integration. I have a BA in English and French and a teaching certificate from Romania, and I have also recently earned a Bachelor of Education from Simon Fraser University with a minor in Curriculum and Instruction. I am a BC Certified Secondary Teacher and a TESOL Canada Certified Instructor. As a passionate lifelong learner, I have attended numerous professional development events, such as this one, over the course of my teaching career, and I also enjoy attending and presenting at conferences and growing my professional learning network, especially through Twitter. In addition, I have been involved in volunteer work. I have been an e-tutor, and I have served on the board of directors of the Association of BC Teachers of English as an additional language, where I strive to support the advancement of my profession. During my long teaching career, I have taught a great variety of courses and worked with different age groups. During all this time, though, one constant has been my belief that my responsibility as a teacher is to create an environment that is caring, inclusive, and respectful of students' characteristics and goals. As far as my professional interests are concerned, I would like to mention just one that has been of particular interest to me lately: the use of current and appropriate technology in education and community building. In my class, we use social media, Twitter to be more specific, to develop digital citizenship skills, practice language, share community resources, and connect with organizations that offer services for newcomers. And now a few words about the organization that I work for. Burnaby School District 41 was established in 1906 to provide public education to the children of Burnaby. As the city grew, the school district recognized that there was also a need to provide educational opportunities for the adult residents of Burnaby and the surrounding communities. Over time, the number of adult education programs grew. Today, a wide range of courses are being offered, such as academic upgrading, vocational programs leading to employment, and recreational courses. In order to meet the needs of a growing population of newcomers, the school district started offering the Language Instruction for Newcomers program, LINC classes, in 1992. The program is fully funded by Immigration, Refugees, and Citizenship Canada. Although it has had two name changes over the past 24 years, the focus of the program has remained the same: to help newcomers successfully settle into their new country. And in LINC classes, students learn more than English. They learn about their new country and explore ways in which they can integrate into Canadian society and enrich its multicultural fabric. Thank you. On to Lily.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. My name is Vivi Wong, and I am very honored to be here today on the unceded coastal territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and the Tsleil-Waututh Nations. I'd like to thank AMSSA team for inviting me here today. This is my first time, so I'm very excited. As Farah mentioned, I am currently the Director of Youth Services at Collingwood Neighborhood House, and I am also supporting a youth leadership education program, which is called the Peer Education Program at Collingwood as well. My passion lies within the community capacity building, youth services initiatives, as well as putting on community events as well. I am also here today to represent a team from the Interactive Project, which was rolled out at the Renfrew Collingwood Intercultural Project. So I am like to talk about that I was very fortunate to work with Donna Chan, a UBC grad student, and together we co-wrote an intercultural physical activity guide. And this guide is called Activities for Everyone, Everywhere, an intercultural physical activity guide, which is designated for anybody in the community to use, which including recreation workers, students, leaders, teachers, youth workers, and as well as parents. This guide might also be an interesting tool for settlement workers as well as LINC providers. Many of these activities that are provided in the guide was originally planned for school-age students, but it could also be enjoyed for any age as well. I have also shared a PDF file of the guide that is available after the talk. In addition, my background is in the Bachelor of Human Kinetics, and I was able to work in schools and nonprofit association for many years, developing youth leadership programs, including day camps, leadership programs, as well as physical activity events. I'm currently a grad student at Simon Fraser University, and I am taking a master education program, which focuses on equity studies in education. I am very fortunate to work at Collingwood Neighborhood House as a neighborhood that I actually grew up from, and is one of the most diverse communities in Vancouver. So there has been a lot of learning opportunity from immigrant families and refugees, and creating very inclusive services that are available for the community. So I'm going to pass it on to Kat.
Thanks, Mimi. Good morning, everyone. I'm also very grateful to be here and to join the panel today with Adrian, Augusta, and Vivi. It's great to be back at AMSSA. I was very fortunate to work at AMSSA until fairly recently, and I worked on the Safe Harbor program here. So not directly in settlement, but I certainly have had an opportunity to learn a great deal about the settlement sector and to gain an appreciation for the hard work that all of you do. I am now working at University of British Columbia in the Community Engagement Office. So the lens that I'm bringing to our conversation today is a little bit on the collaborations between post-secondary education and the settlement sector. And I'd like to present some ideas today that I hope might spark some innovation for you in your own programs. So Vivi has just described the Renfrew Collingwood Interactive Project, and I was very fortunate to be working at Collingwood Neighborhood House with Vivi at the time that program started to develop. And at the same time that initiative was starting, there was a professor at UBC called Dr. Wendy Frisbee in the School of Kinesiology who started to explore interculturalism as a tool, physical activity as a tool for interculturalism. And we've used the term interculturalism, Adrian used it already, and just to describe it, I'll show you this document that will be available afterwards, Interculturalism 101. This was something that the folks in the Renfrew Collingwood community developed together to describe what it is. But it is something, a long word to describe what I'm sure you're all already doing, and it's about the connections between cultures as opposed to multiculturalism, which promotes more siloed thinking. Interculturalism, the theories around that, is really connecting across differences and thinking about culture very, very broadly beyond where we're from. So this course developed at the same time as the project in the Renfrew Collingwood neighborhood. And students in the course had an opportunity to do what we call community-based experiential learning. And that is to actually do some placements and come and experience, put their work into practice. Many students came and did projects at the neighborhood of Renfrew Collingwood, and gained that practical experience, which more and more post-secondary students are demanding to have in their academic career. Some examples of projects I'll give, and I'll highlight a few throughout our conversation today. Students were involved in co-developing intercultural walking clubs. And what makes a walking club intercultural? Students were involved in looking at how seniors programs could be more inclusive using the very guide that Vivi showed us. Also, students I've found in the classes, as I'm now teaching the course at UBC, a large proportion of students are multilingual, and we've had students involved in doing translation and interpretation for different programs. Hosting students, I just want to acknowledge, is certainly a tremendous amount of work on community-based organizations, and the short-term nature of projects is not ideal for everyone. Mm-hmm. But the feedback has been from those organizations that have hosted students that they have gained some really creative ideas, and particularly when projects were paired up with people working in the community, and there was a real focus on mm-hmm. sustaining ideas. So I'll highlight a few more things as we talk. I just also wanted to acknowledge the work of the Renfrew Collingwood community and how much the University of British Columbia has gained throughout that partnership.
Great. Thank you very much, panelists. I look forward to some great discussions. We will now hear from our first case presenter, Jackie Bernier from Smithers Community Services Association. Please wait one moment while Sabrina connects Jackie over the phone.
Hello.
Hi, Jackie. This is Farah and Sabrina calling from AMSSA. How are you today?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Good. Thank you so much for joining us.
I'm very happy to be joining you.
Great. Well, before we start with your case study, I just wanted to briefly introduce you to our online audience.
Okay, great.
So Jackie Bernier works as an employment case manager with new immigrants and refugees at Smithers Community Services Association in Smithers, BC. She moved to Smithers 5 years ago from Victoria, where she worked with domestic and international students as an employment educator at the University of Victoria. Jackie has a master's degree in professional communications and has experience in conference and event planning, radio advertising, and community development. Now, I would like to hand it over to Jackie to share her presentation with us. Thanks, Jackie.
Great, thank you for that nice introduction. I'm really happy to be joining you all today. I'm relatively new here at Smithers Community Services, so I am stepping in for Petra Kost, who is our program coordinator. And I'm going to talk about our game nights that we did last summer for our clients. So we'll start with the first slide here. So my presentation, I'm going to talk a little bit about our community of Smithers and briefly about the Smithers Community Services Association. And within that, our English Language and Multicultural Services Program. So if you hear me refer to ELMS, E-L-M-S, that is the English Language and Multicultural Services Program that we work within here at Smithers Community Services Association. And then I'll be talking about the case study itself, of course, our Friday night game nights. So I'll be talking about the project development, some of the key elements, and of course our successes and challenges. So if we could flip to the next slide, please. So just to give those of you who are unfamiliar with Smithers an idea of what we're all about, we're a small mountain town with about 6,000 residents. And we are located on the Trans-Canada Highway, about halfway between Prince Rupert and Prince George. So it's about a four-hour drive to Prince George and about 2.5 hours to Terrace. And Smithers is a really neat community. I have found since I moved here that many of the people I've met who live here live in Smithers by choice because they're really attracted to the lifestyle here. So Smithers is really known for our outdoor recreation year-round. We've got everything from fishing, hunting, golfing, hiking, skiing, paddling, snowmobiling. We've kind of got it all in Smithers if you're an outdoor enthusiast. So can we flip to the next slide, please? So Smithers Community Services Association, we're an accredited charitable organization with 40-plus years of experience in developing and delivering programs, services, and partnerships that enhance the quality of life for all members of the community. And we offer quite a wide range of programs at Smithers Community Services. So in addition to the English language and settlement assistance services that we provide, we also provide affordable family housing, assisted living facilities. We have a volunteer center. We provide foster parenting and caregiver support, literacy training, public transportation, and other social services programs. So having ELMS embedded within the Smithers Community Services Association, along with its accreditation, gives a relatively small program like ELMS all of the advantages of a well-developed organizational infrastructure. So for example, that organizational infrastructure provides policies and protocols around client confidentiality, client worker professional boundaries, screening volunteers, and safety procedures. So it's a really well-developed, solid foundation that the English Language and Multicultural Services Program is embedded within. Can we flip to the next slide, please? So the English Language and Multicultural Services Program really empowers newcomers to Canada to live full lives in our community. So we offer a variety of different services. Firstly, we offer LINC classes and volunteer tutor matching. So we've got a really strong core of about 10 to 15 volunteers who work very intensively with clients on a weekly basis. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in the later slides. We also provide settlement assistance and employment services, cultural learning activities. So for example, a couple of weeks ago, we organized an event where we took our clients curling, and we had some people there showing us how to curl. I had never curled myself before, and it was a lot of fun. We had people of all ages show up. So we often do things like that. We've done a town hall tour, cross-country skiing, bear aware training, which is really important up here, and tickets to live theater events. So we've really found that our cultural activities also enable networking with local community members, which can ultimately lead to employment and housing, friendships. In a small town, it's really all about who you know. So these events are ultimately designed not only to get people out and having fun and socializing, but also making those connections with the broader community. And then in addition to the cultural learning activities, we also have weekly drop-in community groups. So for example, we do a Saturday coffee and talk every Saturday morning. And this is just an informal get-together at a local cafe so people can practice their English and connect with each other. If we can go to the next slide, please. So our client demography is quite interesting. We've got quite a diverse community up in Smithers. So in the last fiscal year, we assisted 75 clients, which, as you can see on the slide, was three times more than we'd planned for. So we had contracts that were planned for 25 clients, and we managed to serve 75 within that budget. And a large part of that was due to our strong volunteer group and also being embedded within the within Smithers Community Services Association had really enabled us to serve that many clients on a small budget. And our clients originated from 24 different countries. So we had about 42% of our clients came from Asian countries, about 31% from Europe, 16% from Africa, and 11% from North and South America. We also had a really diverse mix of ages. So we've got children of all ages, young adults, middle-aged adults, and those who are either retired or close to retirement. And we can flip to the next slide, please. So in our department, the English Language and Multicultural Services Program, we have a staff team of 4 people, all of whom are part-time, so it works out to a full-time equivalent of about 2.2 staff members. So we have our program coordinator, who is Petra Kost. Petra is currently in Germany, so she'll be back next week, but she's enjoying some time off in Germany. We have settlement support and community engagement worker, and that is mostly Petra that covers that piece, but I do a little bit of that as well. And then we have myself, the employment services case manager. And this is a really unique position here at Smithers Community Services, because the employment services case manager is a role that is typically provided by WorkBC via WCG International. WCG, I believe, stands for Where Careers Grow, and it's an international organization that contracts employment-related services. So having this position within the ELMS program enables us to provide the employment program of BC services to immigrants. And all funding for this role comes from the WCG contract with WorkBC to deliver services to this area. So if a client is not eligible for WorkBC services, we can also assist them with employment via our settlement services. In addition to the employment services case manager, of course, we have our English language instructors. And we have added a new instructor, actually, just in the last few weeks, because our clients told us that what they most needed was English language instruction. So we shifted our funding to be able to provide more language instruction, and we hired a new instructor. In addition, we've got volunteer tutors and mentors. So we sort of have 2 different types of volunteer tutors, or two different types of volunteers, rather. One is our volunteers that tend to come out more for the group events, so like our social activities, English practice, Saturday morning coffee and talk, etc. And then we also have volunteers who do one-to-one tutoring. So we match the volunteers with our clients, and they do tutoring for English language, helping people prepare for driver's tests, that kind of thing. Can we flip to the next slide, please? So the English Language and Multicultural Services Program, our main funders are the federal government through Language and Settlement Services with IRCC. And then we also receive top-up funding from the provincial government. And that funding enables us to provide services for clients who are not eligible for the federal funding. So the top-up enables us to work with temporary foreign workers and naturalized Canadian citizens. And then, of course, we have funding for my position, which is through WCG International. So approximately two-thirds of our clients are funded federally by our IRCC, and about a third are funded by the provincial government funding. If we can go to the next slide, please. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about our Friday games nights. The first slide you'll see here is a graphic, and it shows just how many Syrian refugees we've had come to Smithers. Smithers is ranked 3rd in BC for the number of Syrian refugees per capita. And over the past couple of years, we've also welcomed families from the Democratic Republic of Congo, as well as Ethiopia and Sudan. So for a small community, we have a really healthy group of newcomers to Canada. We'll flip to the next slide, please. So our Friday night games nights, the idea was to organize a weekly game night during the summer when we observed the following developments. We had a drastic increase in client numbers in 2016. As I mentioned, we served 75 clients on a 25-client budget. And that was when Smithers welcomed 25 refugees from Syria and the Democratic Republic of Congo. So we had some budget limitations while we were trying to accommodate this surge of clients. We submitted requests to increase our budget, and those were unfortunately not successful. So we got creative, and we tried to shift our programming from from more one-to-one settlement support to group activities, which really enabled us to serve more clients' needs. And we'd had good experience with game night activities and the municipal campground as a venue for potluck picnics. So game nights also provided an opportunity for clients to meet with staff members for their settlement needs, and it enabled us to include many clients on a very low budget. So I'll talk about some key elements of the project if we can just flip to the next slide. So, of course, with using a municipal campground and park, there was a very low cost for the program, and that was really necessary. We needed to find activities that would suit and speak to all ages, skill levels, cultural backgrounds, language levels. We needed an activity that could accommodate different group sizes, so if we only had 5 people show up, or if we had 25 people show up, we needed to have something that would work for everybody. And we wanted an integrative activity that would connect newcomers to longtime community members. Of course, accessibility and facilities of the venue were really important as well. And we wanted to make sure that there would be good continuity of the project. So, especially during the summer months when a lot of different services like schools take breaks and there aren't as many sort of formal opportunities for those community connections to happen. And it was important to do an activity that reflects kind of what Canadians typically do in our free time as well, and something that would be good for volunteers to participate, and of course with the objective of it being fun. So we want everybody to have a good time. We can flip to the next slide, please. So why did we choose the municipal campground? It's free of charge. It's very close to town, so it's easy to walk to, bike to, or car, take your car. There are great facilities there. They have a little shelter with a cookhouse in case of bad weather. There are washrooms, park benches, tables, fire pits, firewood, and a new kids' playground. As well, the day use area is frequently used by locals, and there are people that camp there from all over the world. So this provided a really interesting opportunity for passersby who were curious about what was happening to kind of stop in and say, hey, what's happening here? And then make some connections with the people who were participating. The park where this was held in, they've got several hiking trails all along the river and up into the forest, and it's quite beautiful. So the idea was to, you know, bring this group of people there, introduce them to this public space where they might come again on their own and enjoy it. Can flip to the next slide, please. So the games themselves, we did simple games to ensure that people with all levels of English could participate, and we encouraged people to bring their own games as well that they wanted to play and introduce. So some of our most popular games were dominoes, cards, Scrabble, soccer, badminton, frisbee, and bocce. And this worked really well for participants who were a bit shy. The games kind of enabled them to come out of their shell a little bit. And we provided space for people to participate in whatever way they felt comfortable as well. So if they just wanted to hang out and chat on a blanket, or if they wanted to get up and play a game of soccer, or just play a quiet game of checkers, it was really up to them. So the space was really free for them to use it the way they wanted to. We can just flip to the next slide. So our volunteers, we last summer had a lovely high school student who came to us and said she was really interested in working with English language and multicultural services and just wanted to help out in any way she could. And so we had her helping to coordinate the Friday games nights. And because she was 16 years old, she had sort of access to a lot of other children and youth. And so she was kind of able to recruit like some of her friends and other volunteers that would participate in a drop-in basis, which was really great for the newcomers who were young people as well to connect with other young people in the community. And we did not actually provide any food for game nights. Participants were very happy to bring snacks and share, and we had campfires going, and of course the s'mores were a very big hit. So So I'll just move into talking about some of our successes and challenges. I'll start with the challenges first. So in the summer, of course, this outdoor venue worked very well because it was nice and warm in the evenings still. But as we got into September, it started to get colder in the evenings here in the mountains and, you know, started to get rainy and that kind of thing. So we tried relocating the event indoors in the classroom, but of course it has limited seating and didn't really allow for more active games. So it kind of stopped in September, October, because we just weren't getting the numbers out anymore, and not having that space to do the physical play was a bit of a challenge. And then also a staff and volunteer availability, that was a little bit challenging because it was always on a Friday night. However, we decided to do this on Friday evenings because it worked best for our clients. So although it was a bit of a challenge, it managed to work out with some staff and volunteer dedication. And finally, I'll talk about our successes, and thankfully there were many. We had great participation. We had a total of 41 clients participating, and on average we had about 14 clients per event, and that was just the adults. So in addition to that, we had about 21 children and about 5 youth. Another big success was, as I mentioned earlier, that community connection. So we had a lot of interest by locals who were passing by, walking their dogs on the trails, and, you know, camping guests from all over the world at the campground would come over and, you know, meet people and sit around the fire with them and make some s'mores. And yeah, that was a great opportunity for connection. Another success was the improvement of communication skills and social interaction. So the games really enabled that, especially with clients with a lower English skill level. So they were able to learn new language for specific activities and games. So for example, racket and birdie were big hits with the badminton, and just things like municipal campground. So they were able to learn those activity and location specific words. And then of course the settlement assistance piece. So newcomers were able to get familiarized with the facility, and they were able to use the area on their own. So that covers our game nights case study that we did last summer. And now I guess we turn it over to questions.
I would like to request that you please stay on the line with your phone muted while I hand it over to the panelists for an analysis of the case study, and then we'll take some questions from our online audience.
Sounds good.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, panelists, over to you.
Great. Hi, Jackie, and thanks very much for sharing about the case study. I just want to start off by saying that I think your ingenuity in finding a way to deal with such an increase in participants with no increase in funding is really commendable and amazing, and it sounds like it went really, really well. There were a couple of things that really stand out in the case study for me. The first one that I really love about this activity was how easy it was for locals and people who just happened to be there, who were camping, to take part in the activity. It really hits on the question that we hear a lot, and I'm sure other service providers hear as well, is that question of how can I meet Canadians and how can I get Canadian friends. And having this activity in the same location and that continuity throughout the summer, where people could just come in and join, really, mm-hmm. I think, enabled that interculturalism and that building of the community, which is really, really important and great for everybody involved. This is definitely a challenge for us in our programs because of funding restrictions. We are not allowed to have citizens on our programs or our courses. So even though we have some activities that are outdoors, because they're every month, people come in. Some locals might be interested and join, but the relationships don't build like they did here. So I really love that about the program. Another thing that I can draw on with our experience is the volunteers and the use of volunteers to make this activity happen. And you mentioned that it was a challenge because of the Friday nights, and I think anytime you're dealing with volunteers, it is really rewarding, but it also brings its own sets of challenges. We have, for the Canadian Fitness Connection Program, we draw on a lot of volunteers for the to do all of the physical activity instructions, and a lot of the workshops are led by volunteers, and the social and educational events as well. We have a cohesive group of volunteers in each location. I think it takes a lot of work and effort and interpersonal skills of keeping those volunteers engaged and drawing on their strengths. So that's really, really great that you could use those volunteers in the program, and especially the youth volunteer, to bring in a whole new demographic into the program. The other thing I wanted to touch on that you mentioned, of course, is the sports and the games that was the base of this program. We in the Canadian Fitness Connection, that whole program is based on sports, and as I mentioned in the intro, we have an hour of doing a group fitness activity together. And as you mentioned, people's language, they forget about their insecurities when they're mm-hmm. taking part in these activities. We also do curling in that program. We do it in the gym with the rocks and rings with Curl BC. And 2 weeks ago, I had a lady look at me after the curling and just say to me, it was very well timed for this event, and she just said, "My English was so much better while we were doing that curling," and it just really reinforced that idea to me of how important it is to get people outside of that normal focus of learning and thinking about their English when it just comes easier for them. I think a word of caution in my experience, the sports are quite easy to do because they're quite cross-cultural. Sometimes with some games, we've pulled like games like charades in, which when it works can work really, really well, and I've seen people get really competitive and really into it, and it's a lot of fun. But sometimes games like that can be really cultural, and mm-hmm. and you think that there's a movie or a book or a song that everybody's going to know, and guaranteed there's always one or two people in the room who that movie you think they'll know, they might not know. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of it in general. I just think it was really great, and yeah, as I said at the start, just hats off for pulling it off and making it work. So I'll leave it to Augusta now.
Okay, thank you. Well, same as you. I believe that Friday Games Night is a great example of a creative response to the needs of a community that supports newcomer integration in the context of budget restrictions. As mentioned by Jackie, the event was accessible, inclusive, and flexible. Mm-hmm. Different group sizes could be accommodated. And what was interesting to me, it was and very creative, it was also the fact that there was an opportunity for staff members to informally assess settlement needs. Mm. And most of all, I would say, it facilitated the development of social networks that can support newcomers' integration, something that Adrian have already mentioned quite a bit. All the key elements of this project could be transferred to a LINC context, especially if a public recreational facility is used. Depending on one's teaching context, a games activity or day can be organized as a class or even as a school event. It could take place on the school premises, or it could be organized as a field trip to a park or a community center, which would increase the benefits of the activity. In this case, I would say it would create opportunities for community connections and would familiarize participants with recreational opportunities in the area. From a language perspective, this would be a perfect example of an activity that is learner-centered and task-based, which are fundamental principles guiding all LINC planning, instruction, and assessment, including PBLA, which is being implemented in all LINC classes at present. This community-related task is a community real-world one in which learners use language to interact meaningfully for a specific purpose. Also, it could be tailored to the students' abilities and learning styles through choice of games and student responsibilities. For example, students with lower levels of language proficiency could be asked to set up the games area, while others could give game instructions and so on. Actually, giving students responsibilities does more than just allowing them to practice their language skills. It gives them a sense of accomplishment and contributes to the development of a sense of belonging, which, according to research, is crucial to newcomers' integration and successful settlement. Also, the sense of belonging seems to correlate with better health, both physical and mental. In order to ensure the success of the event and get the most out of it, pre- and post-teaching activities need to be carefully planned, and they should address all the five components of the CLB model of communicative language ability. For those not working in LINC, CLB stands for Canadian Language Benchmarks, which is basically a document that sets the national standard for planning and instruction in adult ESL programs. The teachers could start with a task analysis to determine the language requirements for successful completion and a needs assessment to see what knowledge and skills the students are missing. Depending on the level, the grammatical and textual knowledge component, for example, could be addressed by teaching games-related vocabulary and sequence markers. Functional and sociolinguistic knowledge might include the language of greetings and introductions, if it's a whole school event, giving following instructions, and cultural tips for polite interactions. To ensure effective communication, which relates to the strategic component, students could learn or review how to ask for repetition and clarification. Higher level classes could also research and present on favorite Canadian games, or even on the impact of social and physical activities on newcomers' well-being, a LINC 8 class, for example. The event could also be advertised with student involvement. Some classes could create flyers, for example, which involves a lot of language learning. Students who use Twitter accounts could tweet during the event. If the school has a website, post activities might include writing an article about the event, with the best one to be posted. In conclusion, I would say that the benefits of such an activity are multiple and outweigh the possible challenge. And very briefly, I would just like to add that in our program, we ran similar activities more than once, such as cultural celebrations that involve games and end-of-year picnics in the neighborhood park, and they were all very well received by students. Thank you, and on to Vivi.
Thank you. So thank you, Jackie. I think the Friday night's events was a beautiful way to highlight the social and physical activity aspect from the community, providing those programs and services. What I really took away from is that the great use of public space in your community and creating a really informal setting for community members to gather together, and because you know we could think beyond that, whether it's learning English or meeting new people, could be outside of formal or institution environment. So I like to say it was a great way to bring people together and really allowing opportunity for them to know their neighbors, not just clients themselves, but like you said, there's people from the park, local members that comes in just really interested in what is going on. So I think knowing your neighbors was really a highlight, and really knowing that, you know, there is a new wave of new settlements and immigrants, families, and how they can interact with each other. So it was a really family-friendly environment, which I think was really important to the clients themselves, because having children, activities available at the same time while parents gathering together, it was a very great support for within the group themselves. I want to highlight that Collinwood Neighborhood House was able to host in partnership with Collinwood, the Police Center, an event called the Summer Night in the Park, and it called Summer Night with Zumba as well. So it was a great way to, each week, we didn't have the capacity to host it every week, but every few months we were able to have a movie playing, and the theme was actually called Movie from Around the World. So different different type of movies was introduced, and we put a spin to it where we say, hey, how can we get this group of people that are already meeting together to be a little bit more active? So we introduced Zumba, because Zumba was really popular in the community. So we hired an instructor. I'm not too sure whether she hired or volunteered her time, but she was able to kind of lead some session there as well. At the same time, we were able to have some trainers to host some stations as well at the event, and led some intercultural games and activities for parents and children as well. So it was a great event where a lot of different activity was happening at the same time. And because everybody was at one place, so it was great to interact with all of them. Another piece that they actually highlight was the potluck. So I think you mentioned a couple of your clients were volunteering to bring snacks and food. So potluck was also introduced in a great way to bring people together. You also mentioned in the case studies that the volunteers aspect, as some of us have highlighted, was to organize and led some activities. And as I mentioned, the intercultural physical activity guide, we were able to provide some training for youth as well that really can not only just lead the activity, but include some dialogue. And for example, asking the children or maybe the parents themselves, because these activities can be modified to many different age range, and really have a dialogue on interculturalism, starting at the very beginning stage of, for example, what type of childhood games you can share with us, and then allowing a platform for whether it's the volunteers, participants themselves, to actually taking like a role of leading and sharing some of the games that they have, they already know and really enjoy playing. But I do like to highlight what Andrea have mentioned. Not all games are the highlight of, not all kids are excited at the same games. And we also had to bring out the respectfulness of making sure we acknowledge some of the comfort level that some of the participants might have. So for example, if there's a game include touching or tag, they could be modified in a way we can use different tools and equipments that we could respect the need of the participants. So, but thank you so much for sharing that case study. It was a great highlight for me.
Great. Thank you to Jackie for sharing the ELMS program. Just I won't take time to reiterate. It was a really awesome program. But what I really love about it is the element of play. And I think that's what we're all sort of commenting on. And when we think about play, we often think about children and youth programs. But adults need to play as well. And Vivia just mentioned the Zumba in the park activity, and I know the neighborhood created a video of that, and it's something that I've used in the course that I'm now teaching. It's this fourth year kinesiology course, to show it as an example of what play and physical activity can do, and the power of that to build a sense of community and spark conversations and make connections. So I've started to use that Zumba video and show it in when I've done conference presentations. I've shown it in class. It's this brief uncomfortable moment when people realize that I'm going to ask them to stand up and dance. But what that does to transform the energy in the room is pretty remarkable. I'm sure that many of you have had that experience. If you somehow manage to do a little bit of exercise in the middle of your day, mm-hmm. or go put your favorite song on and have a little dance party, like what that does for your energy for the rest of the day. And when you're able to do that with a group of people, it's mm-hmm. it's pretty remarkable. Finding the time to do that is something else. A comment too I wanted to add, Vivia talked about the Intercultural Physical Activity Guide, and I'll probably keep mentioning it because I think it's a wonderful tool, and it's something I've used as an assigned reading in the kinesiology course. But picking up what Adrian was talking about, culturally safe activities, mm-hmm. I think there's about 37 activities described in detail in this guide, and they are international activities. So there are different examples of activities that are played worldwide. And maybe a question when I get through my little part here I could ask Jackie is, I'm wondering about the conversations that might have been sparked from activities. Because what I've seen through this intercultural physical activity guide is sometimes playing an activity will remind someone of an activity that they grew up playing. Mm-hmm. I know I've seen people do different skipping activities, and then quickly it turns into conversations of the skipping game that they used to play as a child, or what they had done in growing up in possibly a different part of the world. And it's pretty remarkable how similar these different activities are, with different names and slightly mm-hmm. different variations. Just to offer some additional ideas, over the past few years, again, I said students were doing some projects working with community-based organizations, and there was a few that I thought might be interesting. One group of students was tasked with coming up with free, spontaneous play activities. As we know, certainly, and Jackie highlighted this, being aware of low budgets in the settlement sector, and being innovative, creative is so important. So these students learned about that, and then had to work with the community to find out what is something that could be free and spontaneous. And one simple activity they came up with was hopscotch, and drawing hopscotches with chalk on the sidewalk in front of the neighborhood house near the SkyTrain station in Vancouver. Simply doing that and then seeing what happens. And they did see that people would, on their way to work or off the commute, see it on the street and try it out. And some small little connections happening and showing one another what to do on the hopscotch and different ideas. Another activity that another group of students came up with was a scavenger hunt. And that was something that was co-created, you remember that one, with the community partners in ways that people could be encouraged to get to know their neighborhood a bit more. And they came up with a clever icon, and it appeared around the neighborhood with a little bit of information about the neighborhood, as well as an activity suggestion, what to do in that part of the neighborhood, perhaps a way to use a park bench for exercise or use some stairs. And then finally, I'll just add, because AMSSA and I had talked about this assignment in this course. And the assignment is to try a physical activity that is culturally unfamiliar to you. And there's purposes around this. Briefly, kinesiology students will in a lot of cases go on to be recreation leaders, physical activity leaders, teachers, occupational therapists, physical therapists. Really, could be anything though. And it's important for them to learn these intercultural skills and how they can design programs. But this, what I've really learned from this activity is for people to work in small groups to first of all have a conversation on what is something that would be outside your culture. So having conversations about your personal cultural identity. And then trying an activity, just as Jackie mentioned, curling was a new activity for her, and imagine what that would have been like. So if it's a whole group of people trying curling for the first time, it can be an opportunity to bond and to have some fun, as well as, I think, paired with opportunities for people to teach about activities that are familiar to them. I think those are two really fun exercises that people can learn a great deal from. So can I pose a question to Jackie?
Sure, yeah.
Can I ask you then, Jackie, just about the conversations that it might have sparked, and did you see people talking about the activities or maybe sharing different ways of playing them that they were familiar with or anything like that?
Yeah, so I have to be honest and say that I was not working with English Language and Multicultural Services or Community Services last summer when this event actually happened. So my knowledge about the event is not actually physically having been there myself, but having Petra, our program coordinator, describe that to me. So I'm not exactly sure how sort of the
language around game participation, you know, being described, exactly how that happened.
Great. Okay, so we do have some online questions. So I'll ask the panel first, and then we'll get to some questions for you as well, Jackie.
Okay.
So one person asked, can anyone comment on the effect these types of activities have on the emotional well-being of newcomers to Canada? So I know you talked a little bit about that 30-second dance party and, you know, how that might you know, make a difference, but maybe we can elaborate on that and discuss that a little bit.
Sure. I could just start really briefly just to get us going. You know, I think that there are studies making links between mental health and play that are good, but I also think that what we would all probably highlight is that space has to be inclusive as well. And Vivi mentioned touch as an example and being sure of that. There's also some small risks in environments like this of making people feel uncomfortable. And so I think building relationships is really important in these activities, and building a sense of trust where someone might feel comfortable also voicing what works for them and what doesn't.
If I could just refer for a second to the feeling of like feeling uncomfortable. Sometimes, like, it just brings to mind with higher level students, it's actually a good opportunity to discuss that, you know, feeling uncomfortable is part of your whole experience of being a newcomer and learning a language. And the most successful language learners are the ones who are willing to take risks and feel uncomfortable. So we can, you know, spin it and think this is the positive way to look at it. And one more comment that I have is just something that came to mind. When adults play games, and they might be first reluctant, but once they get into the games, they usually enjoy them. And I think that what it does sometimes is just like brings back happy memories, and then creates like emotionally like a safe space, and you can see how they really start, you know, connecting with each other and talking about happy memories. And so I think that's one thing that it does in terms of, you know, emotional response.
Great, thank you.
Just want to echo what Kat had mentioned of really taking the time to really know your group is important, and understanding that relationship, obviously we all know it takes a lot of time, and creating a safe space, that is where it comes hand in hand. And when you establish all that fundamental, people start to speak and share, and emotions start, you know, to come out as well. You know, whether it's comfortable, happiness, and sadness, I think it is the fundamental is creating that environment for participants, and it takes time.
And just to add on to what Augusta said too, it's actually good whether those emotions that come up are positive or negative, if it's that safe space that's created, because that's a really great time to practice those language skills of saying, I'm not comfortable here, with people that you know, because people are going to have to express that out in a place where maybe they don't feel so comfortable doing that. So, it's a good practice for that as well.
Okay, thank you so much. So, just a reminder that we are taking your questions. You can use the live stream chat box, Twitter, or email your questions to events@amsa.org. And I do have a couple of questions for Jacqueline. Jacqueline, as an employment specialist, what opportunities do you see to integrate social and physical activities into employment services?
That's a good question.
Yeah.
I think, more generally speaking, we tend to, sort of a lot of the employment and settlement work that we do really is blended at community services. So, for example, you know, if we have an organized social event or a cultural event or something like that, like these game nights or curling or whatever, it often provides that opportunity for connection where it might be difficult to connect at other times for various reasons, you know, due to people not having voicemail or struggling to reach them during the day because they're working, or language challenges in, you know, talking over the phone to make plans. Whereas if some clients come and attend the recreational opportunities or events, that gives them an opportunity to sort of, for lack of a better expression, kill two birds with one stone, where they can come and have access to the staff that they would normally see, but in an informal setting. So if they were needing support with something related to employment, like, for example, maybe they need help with their resume, or maybe they had a job and they've just lost the job and they need to come back into case management to help find a job, then just having the physical presence of myself and or Petra and our other staff members at these events sort of provides the opportunity for that, you know, that two-in-one where you're doing the recreational piece and the social connection, but also having access to the staff members for those employment services.
Great. Thank you. Another question we have for you, Jackie, is youth engagement, and we're talking about 14 to 25, has become a priority for the settlement sector. What advice can you give to SPOs on engaging youth in these types of activities?
Well, I think that having a volunteer, in our case, last summer for the games nights, who came directly from the high school and was really eager. I mean, she came to us, you know, really eager to help out. So that definitely facilitated a huge connection with a community of youth here in Smithers. But there's also things like, for example, Work BC that provides the employment services. They recently did a youth week, and so we were going into the high school doing different presentations around things like resumes, cover letters, interview skills, job search, that kind of thing. So I think that this new sort of focus on bringing young people in has really come around on our end too, and so this youth week that we did is kind of part of that. But I really think that getting into the high school and just having an opportunity to talk about, you know, what we do sort of naturally piques the interest of young people, and maybe that's a good way to sort of reach out, is, you know, be talking to the high schools and doing presentations about the type of work we do, and essentially doing a call out for volunteers as well is a way to sort of recruit young people.
Do we have time for one last question? Yep. Okay, so this is for everybody, and maybe we can start with Jackie and then switch over to the panel. So do you think the success of the games night was partially due to the media attention in Syrian refugees this year? And if so, how can we sustain the community engagement as media interest dies down?
From our perspective, I really, it might sound odd, but I don't think that the heavy media focus on Syrian refugees necessarily played a huge role. I think it was more in our community, we were just simply responding to the sort of surge that we had of people coming into Smithers. And there was not a lot of, I mean, there was a bit of local media attention for sure. But I think it was more around, we've got such a strong network of volunteers and people that are involved, not just with the English language and multicultural services aspect, but also with Smithers Community Services more as a whole. So I don't know. I really feel like it was more kind of people coming together to make it happen and just talking to each other, really keeping in close contact with our clients, and then, of course, our clients that had forged contacts and networks and friendships in among themselves, sort of, you know, hey, are you going to this games night on Friday night? Well, if you're not, you should really think about coming because it's going to be a lot of fun. And so I think it was more, I think it was more grassroots than that.
Okay. That's good to know. Thank you. I'll turn it over to the panel. Any other thoughts from the panelists?
I would actually tend to agree with Jackie. We serve in our program some refugees, but a lot of them aren't refugees. We have clients who've been here for years, and I think it's a little bit going back to that building your volunteer base, mm-hmm. and making them really mm-hmm. aware of the importance of the programs, mm-hmm. and just having that dialogue with people. It is definitely a buzzword, and you know, if you say to people, say that refugees, then often you might get some more interest. But for us, it's been just the programs have been established for so long that I don't feel like it's mm-hmm. made a big difference. I don't know what you guys think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I kind of feel the same, and I think that probably Jackie has already mentioned, it sounds like there is a lot of community engagement mm-hmm. in Smithers, and there are really strong social networks there. And maybe another element might have been the use of public space, mm-hmm. Just could be. Okay. And maybe it just makes me think that maybe in terms of future events, just kind of think of using this public space more, because mm-hmm. it might attract more interest and create more opportunities for engagement mm-hmm. with people in the community. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to add also, when it comes to the volunteerism, you know, how can we help sustain some of these events or services, is to really take in the time to assess, you know, who are the community that want to really, really get involved. Mm-hmm. And I kind of call them the community champions or champions of the mm-hmm. community, and see if there's any way if they want to be connected in one particular aspect of the services, whether maybe, you know, leading activities, mm-hmm. or maybe there are chefs and they maybe want to create community kitchens and bring people together once a week or once a month, and have a diversity of conversation, because I think that will be a great opportunity to allow community members, but also open up a platform for those participants or families and clients to mm-hmm. Create and transitioning of, yes, they're receiving these, you know, participating in these programs and services. Now, how can we create opportunity for them to maybe take more of a leadership opportunity as well? So working closely for those who like to be more involved and give back to the community as well, and be the bridger. Yeah.
Thank you, Kat.
Nothing to add. That's
okay. Great. Thank you so much. Well, thank you, everyone, for your questions and your input on today's case study. And thank you, Jackie, for joining us today. We really appreciate your time.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate the opportunity. And yeah, it's been a lot of fun.
Great. Thanks, Jackie.
Okay.
Have
thank
a great
you.
Day. Bye.
Bye.
Okay, we will now hear from our second case study presenter. And standing in for Michelle Redfern is Sabrina Ziegler. She is the settlement coordinator at AMSSA. Unfortunately, Michelle could not be with us today due to the severe weather conditions out in Cowichan. So I will pass it over to Sabrina. But I would, you know, maybe like to introduce Michelle just a little bit. So Sabrina, if you want to come up and do that, or you want me to do that? Okay, so Michelle Redfern has been working as a settlement coordinator for the Cowichan Intercultural Society for almost 5 years. Her work is predominantly focused on providing employment assistance to all clients and wraparound support to the more vulnerable immigrants and refugees. Michelle comes from a social work background and has extensive experience working with other government and nonprofit organizations on Vancouver Island, as well as overseas in Kenya, Uganda, and the Democratic Republic of the Congo. So we thank Michelle very much for sharing this case study with us today that Sabrina will present.
So before I start off with the case study, I just wanted to provide some background information. The Cowichan Intercultural Society was started in 1981 as a community response to help Vietnamese refugees. For the past 35 years, CIS has continued to serve newcomers to Canada in the region while striving to build an inclusive and welcoming community where every person feels valued and has a sense of belonging. So as this map here indicates, the Cowichan Valley is located on southern Vancouver Island and is bordered by Nanaimo and Alberni regional districts to the north and to the northwest. As of the 2011 census, the regional district has a population of approximately 80,000, with a total immigrant population of approximately 10,000. The service center for the region is in the city of Duncan, and that is where the office is also located. CIS also offers regular monthly services at satellite locations located around the region and will schedule appointments in these areas at other times or on an as-needed basis. IRCC in the province of BC funds CIS to provide settlement services in their region. The programs are mentioned on the slide and probably resemble many other organizations who are participating in today's event, so I won't go through each of the different programs that are offered. CIS also uses fundraising, grants, their social enterprise, membership contributions, and donations to augment existing programming and fund additional programs and endeavors, such as their Compassionate Leaders and Multicultural Leadership Group youth programming, community outreach initiatives, limited child minding, and their annual One World Festival. CIS currently has 23 full-time, part-time, and contract staff, although not all work in the area of settlement. There are two full-time settlement coordinators who provide the majority of needs assessment, information, orientation, and employment assistance for the clients. You can see by the numbers that volunteers play an essential role in helping CIS clients settle, adapt, and integrate into the community. The organization has 120 different volunteers who they're working with. So this slide here shows the approximate number of clients that CIS has served in 2016, with IRCC eligible clients being 275, 130 BC eligible clients, 25 other clients, and they have 75 clients registered in their LINC programs. As a smaller center, there are fewer organizations to support the needs of newcomers and not enough staff to have specialists in every area. Consequently, CIS settlement staff have a very broad range of knowledge and skills in order to help and support the diverse and complex needs of their newcomers. Services are most likely offered on a one-to-one format, as there's not enough clients from a particular group or with a particular need to create group programming. So this was up last year when CIS welcomed 72 Syrian refugees. 42 of these refugees that arrived in the community were government-assisted refugees who spoke no English and had no understanding about life in Canada, and CIS became their only source of support. The GARs needed an enormous amount of service delivery time and extensive support wraparound. CIS settlement staff also worked with sponsorship groups to provide information and resources so that sponsored refugees also receive the settlement support that they would need. In June of 2016, settlement staff was stretched with settling the GAR families and welcoming four new families. LINC classes were winding down for the summer to shut down, and CIS realized that with only 1 year of resettlement assistance support guaranteed and the clock ticking on the year, they needed to find a way for English classes to keep going in the summer months. So if they were to provide English classes for the adult participants of the program, they also needed to provide programming for 35 children, as only three of the children were able to take part in mainstream recreational programming due to their higher level of English. The remaining children needed a program where they could grow their own English language skills and knowledge of the Canadian classroom, a program where their highly anxious parents could know that they were safe and cared for in a culturally sensitive environment, and a program that was something that was fun so that the children would enjoy and look forward to coming. So the challenges that CIS experienced when putting together this program was that it was, of course, a shoestring budget, insufficient space in their office to provide programming, a limited public service transit schedule, the BC childcare legislation that mandated children under 5 being on the same premise while the where the service for parents operates, no Arabic speaking staff or volunteers available to support the program, the need to recruit and screen several volunteers in a short period of time, and a multi-age group of children. So CIS did what all organizations in the sector do. They leverage their community connections. So this is a map where the programming took place. And you can see on this map there's Vancouver Island University, which is accessible by bus, and that provided the classroom space for the English language classes to happen half days, Monday to Thursday for 6 weeks. The rest of the program was kind of built around the university and kind of with the facilities that were available. So the Cowichan School District provided an early learning center called Wendy's House for the 11 children under 5 and their mothers. Child minders supported by volunteers cared for the children, while volunteer tutors worked on English with the mothers. A field between the university and Wendy's House became the focal point for the 25 children between the ages of 6 and 16 who attended the day camp. KidSport funded 10 survival skill swimming lessons for the children, as newcomers to Canada are 4 times more likely to be unable to swim and therefore more at risk of drowning. Duncan Lane's bowling alley, which you can see at the bottom left of the picture, provided a huge discount on bowling, which enabled the group to go 4 times in the 6 weeks. As well, the Cowichan Green Community, which is just outside of the map area, provided a commercial kitchen for 5 cooking classes, and volunteer teacher managed that program. The Cowichan Soccer Association provided a huge sack of soccer balls for usage. A team of counselors volunteered their time to put on arts-based activities for different age groups once per week, and the Vancouver Island University provided a room for this. The Vancouver Island Public Library, which is between the Aquatic Center and the bowling alley, provided a classroom space in case it was raining. The private sponsorship groups which were participating in the programming supported it with volunteers and with donations. So with no confined space, hot summer sun and little shade, lots of walking to different activities with no public restrooms, children who spoke little English, and some children with special needs, there were risks that the organization needed to manage. 2 staff were hired and over 35 volunteers were recruited for the day camp alone. All of these volunteers except one were high school students, and most changed their work schedules in order to be available and participate in the camp as much as it possibly could. After the first day, the seasoned educational assistant who had been hired to lead the camp quit due to the complexities that she experienced in the group. A settlement coordinator needed to step in until another person could be found and trained, which took 6 weeks' time. The most popular activity was swimming, and the participants were happy to spend an hour or two after their lessons playing in the pool with the volunteers. The lesson had to be adapted because of the language barrier, but the important safety context was understood. Children who were initially very reluctant to get in the water were patiently coaxed and coached by volunteers until they were playing alongside their peers. Girls who refused to swim due to modesty issues eventually joined in the fun after settlement staff worked with their parents to come up with an acceptable swimwear. I heard from Michelle that the organization got very crafty and sewed many different acceptable swimwear for the girls. A tremendous amount of Canadian culture was communicated tactily to the children, and youth had to navigate the changing room experience, swim, and interact in a co-ed pool, learn how to listen to the safeguard and cue in an orderly fashion at the side. A downside was that the children loved the swimming so much that they refused to go to the art program on their scheduled day because they all wanted to go swimming again. The cooking class was another popular activity, with the participants proudly carrying their wares back to the university to share with their parents. The home ec teachers marveled at the group of young children who heaped olives onto their pizza. The board games at the library was not a popular event and only happened once, as the children did not respond well to being confined. They preferred to play soccer in the rain. Interestingly enough, the dynamics between the children were easier to manage when playing soccer and working together as a team to create more harmony. The next activity was bowling, and that was an activity that was really well received. It became a teaching opportunity to learn about patience and to model encouragement with lots of exuberant high fives and praise to each other. What was particularly wonderful about seeing how the whole camp cheered for a 13-year-old girl with Down syndrome because it was her turn. Bowling was her favorite activity, and everyone else felt happy watching how much she enjoyed herself. Her siblings were highly protective of her, and it was wonderful to see them all start to relax in this environment. There was also art-based activity groups. A local therapist who had successfully worked with some of the traumatized children who had arrived earlier in the year put together a team of volunteer registered counselors to facilitate weekly age-grouped expressive activities. The groups were well planned with lots of interesting art objects, and the children definitely responded to the approach. Strategies were taught to recognize emotions, build upon resiliencies, and cope with stress. The 13 plus age group did not enjoy attending the group as much as the younger children, especially if their time meant they would miss their swimming. They preferred being active and playing, with many reported that they were not able to do this prior to coming to Canada. Soccer. The grounding activity for the group was playing soccer, whether it was at a proper scrimmage or just kicking the ball around. Many other games were played on the field, including soccer, baseball, but soccer was the most popular and seemed to be the way how participants could relax. Every morning would start with soccer and they would end the day playing soccer, with dads coming to join the game and mothers kicking the ball with their toddlers. One dad asked to borrow a ball on the weekend and commented how happy he felt while kicking it around with his wife and children on Saturday, and that made them feel safe and belonging, that they belonged to the community. He even said that his wife had lost weight and was becoming much fitter since coming to Canada because it was safe for her to leave the house and to play with the children outside. Soccer was so popular that settlement staff applied for grants for more than 20 children to join the league in September. While not all registrations worked out, there was at least 15 Syrian children participating and playing on community teams each week. Newcomer parents stand on the sidelines chatting with Canadian parents and all take tremendous joy in watching their children play. Newcomer families have learned about arriving on time for a game, following a schedule, attending even in the rain and cold, arranging for rides with other parents, and being part of the great Canadian tradition of Soccer Saturday. Most importantly, relationships are being built, integration and belonging are happening, and social isolation is being prevented. So the final event of the summer camp was the children were bused to a park with a small suspension bridge and a swimming hole. A lifeguard from the pool where they had previously taken the lessons, who walked over to the office to sign up to volunteer after seeing the group at the pool, arranged for other lifeguards to come and to stand duty. Many of the children swam outside for the first time, and their enthusiasm and joy was palatable. An outdoor education teacher volunteered his time to play a few races and set up an obstacle course with the kids. After 6 weeks together, the children's English had improved tremendously, their understanding of the Canadian classroom etiquette had improved, and they were much more confident about entering the Canadian school system in September. And finally, one thing Michelle mentioned to me was that swimming was such a success for the children that CIS was able to get discounted family access passes to the rec center after the program ended. And so many kids, because they felt so comfortable in the pool and loved to go swimming in the pool, that they brought their parents to the pool and have integrated and helped their parents get used to the public swimming pool. So now they all regularly take part.
Great. Thank you so much for presenting on behalf of Michelle, Sabrina. Appreciate it. Very interesting case study. Lots of challenges, but I guess it was very successful in the end. So I'll turn it over now to the panelists, and you can take it away with your analysis, and hopefully we'll have some questions as well.
Sure.
Thanks.
Thanks, Farah. Thanks, Michelle and Sabrina, as well, for the case study. The adaptability of CIS with this program is truly amazing. And you can tell by the pictures and the feeling that it was just an amazing summer for everybody involved. Mm-hmm. One thing that struck a chord with me, there were a few things, but one thing that was mentioned in the notes that we got was the challenge surrounding getting the group to gel and to mm-hmm. come together. And even though they were from the same country, that was a bit of a challenge. And I can really speak to this in our context of the Canadian Fitness Connection Program. That's a very diverse group in age and in background. And getting them to really gel is so, so important. The workshops that we have in that program are can become really personal for people. We talk about things like mental health and depression. Mm-hmm. We talk about coping strategies and stages of adjustment and conflict resolution. And if you don't have a group that feels connected and comfortable with each other, obviously sharing your experiences and talking about your feelings related to those topics is really hard. So putting the effort in early to get the group to gel mm-hmm. is really important and can sometimes be a challenge. We find that having a lot of icebreakers really helps. Also, we have a snack and socializing time in that Fitness Connection program. And depending on the group, some groups will pick up on it really easily and be really social. Other groups, for whatever reason, are a little bit more reserved. And I find that even if I just give them a question, and it can just be like, talk about something you did that was positive for your health this week, kind of having that, it's almost like they have permission then to go up and talk to somebody who's from a different culture than them, and then they'll go and do that, and then that kickstarts a conversation, and then I can't get them to stop talking. So also with that, just sometimes logistics as well. I found that if I put workshops that I lead at the start of the course for the first few weeks, then I can allow the time for those icebreakers where I wouldn't maybe feel as comfortable with a guest speaker getting them to use up some of their time for icebreakers. So just really, really important, I think. And also with that, sports really help as icebreakers too, and physical activity. I mean, there's nothing like to break the ice, like getting everybody moving or doing Zumba. Something else with this case study that stood out for me was the partnerships and the logistics involved. Just really heavy and intense planning. Mm-hmm. We have quite a few partnerships in the Canadian Fitness Connection Program as well. and those are really invaluable to us and, of course, to the participants, because they're a really great way to connect participants to the community. Mm-hmm. Something else that I loved about this program was the continuation of the connections made with the community after the designated end date of the program. I think with the soccer and getting the kids enrolled in the soccer mm-hmm. and getting them to continue is just so fantastic. And as Sabrina mentioned, then it's not only the kids who are involved, but the parents are involved. And like they said, what is more Canadian than standing in the cold in the rain watching your kid play soccer? So it's just really great. We strive to do this in the Canadian Fitness Connection Program. I haven't mentioned, but any time that a participant joins that program, they get a free 3-month membership to the YMCA for their family as well. So all of the activities that we choose to do in the program are something that they can do when they're not in our course. So they can, they're encouraged to come with their families, and if it's Zumba that they do and they love, then that's great, and come back anytime that the Y is open and do it. If it's an activity that's not at the Y, like curling, we really make sure that they know how to get involved and where they can go to join that activity. It can also be a challenge to do this though, because everybody has the momentum when you're in the course, and then when the course stops, we don't have the resources to follow up with people and give them that encouragement to keep going. We try and mitigate that by, again, going back to getting that group to gel so that they can try and support each other after the course finishes to do that, whether it's through social media or however they choose to do that. We also have a workshop in the Fitness Connection course that's on low-cost fitness and recreation in your community. In Vancouver, that includes a walk with stops along the way, like at a community center, and what can you do here, and how do you access it. We also stop at outdoor swimming pools and tennis courts along the way. And then the last thing that I wanted to mention was just about the sports and the fun that you can, are just palpable with this case study, and just the power of sport. It just really brings people together, as you can get the feeling from in this program. And that the football, I mean, how easy is football, right? They said they had a bag of balls that they got donated, and that just became the flagship activity for this program. There's also challenges with sport, and they mentioned the swimming, which is something I can relate to, because we have Aquafit as one of our fitness activities in the Fitness Connection program, and with our group, it's really multicultural. So we have, you know, people who are from Latin America who, you know, being in water and beach culture is part of their culture to other cultures where it's not. So we try and deal with that, again, with that gelling of the group and building rapport and just having open dialogues of, like, what do you feel comfortable wearing, and letting them wear what they're comfortable in. And we don't force anybody. If they're not comfortable, then they don't have to do it. But we do encourage them to come to the fitness safety portion of that workshop, that fitness activity, so that they're getting that element of it. The other thing with the sport is just the fun, and to draw on the Zumba chat that was happening earlier. Zumba is one of our activities, and it, I think, is my personal favorite. I don't love Zumba, but I do love looking around the room and just seeing people from their early 20s to, I think, the oldest gentleman I've had doing Zumba is in his 70s, and people from all different walks of life and cultural backgrounds participating in Zumba, and they always have a smile on their face, and I've seen grown men elbow each other to get to the front, right in front of that instructor, and for that hour that we're participating in that activity, they're not stressing about their language or their job or, you know, all of the other stresses that are involved with newcomers and their transition here. Mm-hmm. So it's just really, really powerful. And thanks for sharing. I really loved hearing about it.
Thank you. What impressed me the most about the summer day camp was how a whole community came together and solved a problem of such complexity through collaboration and creative solutions. And this is clearly a community that values its cultural diversity, as indicated by the sheer number of volunteers involved. Through this event, I believe that the Intercultural Society's objectives have definitely been met. And two of these in particular have made me think of how we can do more to address these issues in a LINC context. These objectives are to promote cultural awareness and appreciation, and to facilitate public awareness and education of common issues across cultures. When the LINC program is delivered by an organization that doesn't provide any other settlement-related services, however, this can be a real challenge, and creative solutions have to be found. In our organization, for example, we often use guest speakers and field trips activities as opportunities to bring cultural awareness to the community. Our resource teachers organize these events after initial consultation with the instructors. Some examples would be the annual Move for Health that we host in collaboration with Burnaby Parks and Recreation, the annual Neighborhood Cleanup, in which we help the community school in our area run the event, Saturday biking classes, and recently a summer gardening club. We have also developed a partnership with the BCIT Nursing Program. Nursing students come and deliver health education to our students, and these events benefit both organizations. Quite often, the presentations turn into real social events during which nursing students and LINC students exchange personal stories and cultural information. This can also be used as an opportunity to collect information about community needs, information that the nursing students can take back to their institution. In each case, a lot of language learning takes place, but not only. As I have already mentioned, cultural learning takes place on both sides, and this contributes to the development of cultural sensitivity. As far as language is concerned, pre, during, and post activities with clear language learning outcomes are prepared by instructors, and they are all CLB aligned. Some are actually PBLA, portfolio-based language assessment, skill building and using activities, or even assessments, which fulfills our LINC instruction requirements. Students can also be asked to reflect on their experience in a way that raises their awareness on the value of these events and also enhances their cultural learning. The events are usually promoted through our school and Twitter accounts, and this way we reach a larger audience. It's also a chance to highlight our students' community engagement and build positive self-image, which is essential to personal quality of life. We also use Twitter to inform our students about recreation resources and services, especially since lack of information is reportedly one of the barriers to accessing recreation services. Reflecting back on the summer day camp for Syrian refugees, I see another huge accomplishment, the social networking that took place, in part because of the volunteers involved. Mm-hmm. Developing social networks is essential for breaking isolation, fostering feelings of inclusion, and creating a sense of belonging. This is especially important in the case of newcomer populations facing multiple challenges. These social networks continue to benefit everybody involved long after the event takes place. Having such a large number of volunteers take part in an event can only increase the chance of promoting cultural awareness in the community, as they will share what they have learned with their own social networks. This has inspired me to consider ways in which we could have more volunteers in our LINC classes. Some avenues to explore would be collaboration with post-secondary institutions and volunteer organizations in the area. For example, the volunteers could help run some of our events, which would create opportunities for interaction. Or we could have a cultural exchange session where volunteers teach LINC students something about Canadian culture in exchange for information about other cultures. And I have to confess that this idea came to me as I was chatting with Kat and discussing what she does with her students, so thank you. Hopefully, the summer day camp will inspire others to find innovative ways to support newcomers' integration, which is largely dependent on creating an environment of mutual respect and willingness to learn and understand, to learn from and understand each other. Thank you, and now back to me.
Thank you. So, of course, the most common theme that really highlight from this case study was, of course, community coming together. And it seems like when there's a need in the community, you know, people will tend to come together and support each other as much as they can. So community partnership really highlighted for me in that way, where whether it is the university providing space at either a low cost, or you know, members from the community such as lifeguards, teachers volunteering their time to provide, you know, certain activities and services from extra supports and supplies or funding from other agency, it really highlights that, you know, the support that the community want to provide. So just to highlight the importance of partnership is that the as I highlight the Renview Interactive Project, what is also a multi-stakeholder project, was involved with a lot of different partners, including Collingwood Neighborhood House, the Renview Park Community Center, Vancouver Coastal Health, Collingwood Policing Center, JW Sparta, Windermere Family of School, Spectrum Society for Community Living, Collingwood BIA, Business Improvement Association, as well as the UBC Schools of Kinesiology. This significant partnership really allowed people coming together in the creation of the Intercultural Physical Activity Guide with myself and Donna Lee worked together. And from receiving feedback of how the guide was developing to really piloting the guide into the community, so many people take a really leadership role from providing space to classroom time, as well as feedback for how we could create more inclusive activities. So from as a result of this partnership with different sectors, we were able to provide training for high school students to take on some of the leadership role of leading activities, to the Collingwood Police Policing Center was able to start a walking club at the residence, and also providing, like I mentioned, moving the park for the community. I also want to highlight the effort the CIS team and also the community from Cowichan was able to really listen and understand the needs of the participants. So for example, adapting the swimming lessons that was needed, I like to highlight it is, you know, the IPEG, which is the Intercultural Physical Activity Guide, really have a section to provide guidelines of how to create inclusive learning environment, but also a component to it is the cultural sensitivity. You know, we would like to encourage teaching and training the young youth leaders, teachers, parents, to really think about the barriers that, you know, yes, sports and physical activity can bring people together, and of course, like everything else, it has their limitation. And so how do we, you know, go beyond that, and how do we modify certain activities, whether, you know, we don't share the same language, to maybe someone has a limited of physical activity level to participate. So we had to be, you know, how do we can be creative and be inclusive at the same time. And like I said, just focusing on the aspect of asset-based approach, and which I think this case study really did a great job in, is really looking to the community of some of the resources and also the individuals of the strengths of the community. So whether, like I said, individual have specific skills to lead arts and craft, to more specifically providing training in swimming, or even like hosting a soccer game in the field, is really kind of reinforcing the role of community connectors or community champions of the society. So able to provide training and workshop for participants to also take on the leadership skills is also a great component as well. I think the last thing I want to, or a few things, one of the last things I like to mention is the dedication of the CIS, and how I was very fortunate to work with the same location of our Collingwood Neighborhood House Settlement team. And by just working with them as neighbors, I was able to really learn that they have often go far and beyond to the work that they do. So for the CSA staff, understanding how to maybe provide a swimwear that is, you know, appropriate for the family, I can see that it really has echoed in our settlement team that our the settlement workers will often, you know, collect supplies or enrolling, finding out children programs in the community that they need their, you know, family to participate in. So I really can see how the passion of the CIS team really echoes, and a lot of the different communities, I'm sure, do the same. And yeah, and I think that what last but not least is the case study also highlight the different way of bringing people together or offering services. So of course, you know, activities and games is one component, but they did really highlight, you know, offering what is available, so such as the cooking classes and the arts. And if they even have space for dance music, I'm sure that will be available. But yeah, I just really like to highlight and congratulate the innovative and creative way of providing services for their participants.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's certainly been a theme of both case studies, I think, so the need for innovation and creation. So I'll try to out a few different points. What's really striking me and the lens that I'm bringing to it is the educational opportunity for the high school students who were volunteers, and it could also be post-secondary education facilities as well. But why that's, you know, I just feel that that is so important is because the high school students or post-secondary students, these are the future settlement workers. These are the future health practitioners and people mm-hmm. that are going to be working and interacting with the community. And it's so important to provide an education in cultural differences, cultural practices. So again, in this course that I've been fortunate to teach, we do use the Intercultural Physical Activity Guide as an assigned reading. And as Vivi mentioned, there's this section on what's needed to create inclusive spaces for physical activity. So we study it, we read it, but there's no better education than getting out there and actually mm-hmm. practicing and having that practical experience for students to be able to recognize differences, recognize the barriers as well, and we've highlighted several barriers to participation. Also realizing that there's different ways to participate, and I think Adrian, you gave an example of that with the swimming program, letting people know what's involved in this activity, and here's a way you can participate in a portion of it. You don't necessarily need to get into the swimming pool, but that's important as well. So I think that it's just really commendable to, you know, whether it was you had trouble finding volunteers and had to go to high schools, we could also shift the way we think about how could we offer educational opportunities. Mm-hmm. And on that note, I should highlight challenges of that work, and I'm not going to pretend it's easy to collaborate. A lot of the, I'll speak more to university programs, tend to be short-term. There is, of course, a time you need to orientate the students, and that is your precious time, and it takes mm-hmm. a lot of time to do that. And if it is short term, you might decide it's not worth the time to do that. So it's something certainly to take into consideration, and also depends who you're working with, in which teacher or faculty. It's an opportunity for them to learn more about community work, but it's a two-way educational mm-hmm. process, and it doesn't work in every situation, and I would certainly caution around the time frame and thinking around mm-hmm. sustainability. Mm-hmm. So when through this course when we've done placements, you know, I approach a bit differently because I've worked at AMSSA, I've worked at Collingwood Neighborhood House. So when going to an organization to see if they want to collaborate on a project, I would ask more, is there something that you're working on that students can assist you with?
Right.
As opposed to what's a brand new project we can just do for the heck of it, and then what happens afterwards. But also grounding the students in something that's ongoing and giving them opportunity to work with community members or staff who would continue that project. And that's something mm-hmm. I would say that Renfrew Collingwood is quite adamant about doing. The walking club example has been provided, and it was the Collingwood Policing Center who took the lead on a walking club at a residence. And we've really tried to pair university students with people in the community who can continue that walking club. And it's been going for 2 years so far. I haven't found that person to really champion that program. So that's an example of something that happens for 2 months every year. But I think there's still efforts to try to make that more sustainable. And finally, I just want to give an example I thought might be relevant to the sector. There was a study done by the Canadian Association for the Advancement of Women in Sport and Physical Activity. And it's called Newcomer Mothers Experience in Physical Activity. And we'll make sure the PDF of that study is available. And I was working at Collingwood Neighborhood House at the time of that study, and they invited the community to be part of it. So I got to work with someone to kind of co-organize those focus groups with newcomer mothers in the community. And the purpose was to hear what mothers' experiences of physical activity are currently, were formerly, and what they were looking for, what barriers they feel, what they were interested in, and interestingly enough, soccer was something that came out. You know, really what mothers were saying is they want activities for themselves. They want time for themselves as well. They have to think about childcare, and they're tremendously busy and have so many things to juggle, but wanting exercise for themselves. So opportunities to come off the sideline and join into the activity. So what the neighborhood did try for a little while was to do an intergenerational soccer game, and had a university student guiding it temporarily, but it was just bring some equipment out into the park behind the Collingwood Neighborhood House and just encourage people to play. And it was very informal, and I think it was successful a few different times, but challenge with that activity was to continue and keep it going, and we didn't have someone to continue that. But the few times, maybe a half a dozen times that we did it, it was pretty remarkable. It wasn't that isolated activity and time for mothers on their own. That wasn't something that we were able to do at that time. But it was a time for mothers to play with their children, with other mothers, and with people who would literally come off of the sidewalk and join in the soccer game, because that's what was being encouraged. And it was a real opportunity to leverage community connections, as Sabrina said.
So can I just ask you a question about that? The mothers said that they wanted time to play sport on their own without their children. Do the sport themselves.
Was something that was challenging, and as the sector would relate to around, you know, getting the space or the cost.
Right.
Also, keeping the cost down was important. So, recreation facilities will try to organize a program at the same time as a children's program, so you can drop your child and then do your own thing.
Mm-hmm.
But we couldn't, but I would say that that's really what the study highlight is wanting more time for themselves.
Okay. Yeah. Great. Thanks.
Great. Thank you very much, panelists. So I understand that Michelle has joined us. She's joined us online. She's chatting with everybody, and she has introduced herself to everyone that's on live chat right now. So if you have any questions, and if our online participants have any questions, please feel free. We can ask them of Michelle. We also have some questions for the panelists. This case study, and all of you, highlighted the importance of community partners in incorporating physical and social activities in settlement programming. Can you give any advice on how to approach and engage potential community partners? Who wants to start?
I think definitely look into local partners and see if there's any correlation of collaboration of projects, whether it is a really look into the existing services and programs that you are offering and see if there's any way that they can support in that sense, or if they are really energetic, if they want to be creative. I think you also have to provide that space of maybe new programs and services need to be discussed, but definitely start with the local. partners, and then it is all about relationship, right? So
yes.
Once you start connecting with one local partners, and next thing you know, even just like setting a meeting and having a short brief of discussion, and then you never know that from that meeting you're able to connect with some others.
Right. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Vivi. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I would just say to identify the needs of both organizations is a good place to start and a way to start the conversation. So in the context of post-secondary partnerships, I had described going and saying, what are you working on? What are you needing? And how can we fill that? As opposed to saying, hey, I really need to get these students some practical experience. Yeah. So can you take care of this?
Yeah.
I know what happens. I think that's really good. So approaching different organizations, you could think of that way is to first listen as well as what their needs are and come up with some creative collaborations.
Yeah, and just sort of say what's in it for them as well, right?
Exactly. That's important for sustainability.
I guess that I just realized that we do think as, partners in terms of YMCA. So as simple as having Adrian on a regular basis come and be one of our guest speakers, and that's where the conversation starts. Mm-hmm. And then we have students joining some of those programs, and then they come back and they talk about them, and when we have really successful experiences with higher level classes, we might even invite students to the higher level classes. We might help them prepare to go to lower level classes and do some presentations. Mm-hmm. And just like, I guess as simple as that, but I am also definitely looking for more ideas in terms of, this is one thing that I've learned that, community engagement and partnership is really important, and I'm trying to find more ideas, but this is just something that just came to mind.
And that's just, I think, an example of what Kat is saying, because that fulfills a need for both of us.
Yeah.
And I think that is the key thing to keep in mind is, it's got to be beneficial for both people, both parties involved.
Yeah, and just to add on, it does, if that's a key aspect that you want to improve on, you definitely need to allocate that from your work time, because it does take time to not just research, but really go into the community and meet with the partners.
Definitely. Thank you. excuse me. So another question is, Augusta has highlighted the importance of reflection in learning. Mm. Can anyone speak to the trend of reflection and mindfulness activities and how these might be incorporated into social and physical activities? Mm. Yeah, mindfulness is that buzzword again, right?
Buzzword.
So,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Any thoughts on that?
I don't know if this is exactly what the person who said the question is looking for, but we have a workshop that I mentioned earlier, which is designed, the whole topic is mental health, and we do some mindfulness activities within that workshop. One of the things that we do is everybody gets a little piece of chocolate, which is always very exciting for people because they get chocolate. And we just go through of like lead them in an exercise of like just being mindful of how does it feel? How does it feel in your hand? Notice how it feels, and then smell it and go through like how does it smell? And just being really conscious and present and mindful while you're then going into eating the chocolate. And then I think with the physical activity, I think the reflection is really important, and instilling that part in a workshop or after an activity of just reflecting on it and how did you feel and asking those questions and just having a really, it doesn't have to take long, like 1 or 2 minutes of getting everybody to share how they felt with the activity.
Yes.
Well, in terms of LINC classes, actually, because of PBLA, portfolio-based language assessment, we do have to ask students to do quite a lot of reflections. But one thing that can be done, and I actually do that with my students, is in terms of discussing how they can become independent learners and what learning a language means. One of the things that we discuss is how important it is for them to go out in the community and practice their language, and how that will also benefit them in terms of language about the culture and also ultimately intercultural communication, just making you know, other people out in the community aware of these many cultures that are around us. And quite on a regular basis, I would say I ask them to reflect on what they've done maybe in the course of 1 week or 1 month, what they've done in terms of going out there and connecting, and also to reflect on what they learn, whether it's language or culture. And then sometimes we share those reflections, just to bring awareness to the students of the importance of these things.
Thank you. Any other thoughts? Reflection, I would just say, is a big part of learning in the course that I teach. And I'm so fortunate to be able to read the reflections that students write, and often sharing their own personal experiences of settlement or those of their parents, but also seeing a shift in people's level of intercultural understanding. And as they learn different cultural competencies, it's quite remarkable. And I'm thinking again of the high school students involved at the CIS program, and I wonder if what that experience would be if they would have reflected on the experience in volunteering in a program like that, and how that has a profound effect on themselves and their own learning. Mm-hmm. A reflection, I think, is a really important tool.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think the exercise with the chocolate also teaches patience, because right. you know, you're not popping it in your mouth
exactly,
right away.
Which always happens this way.
Okay. We have another question. The panelists have mentioned challenges with getting clients from different cultures engaged with each other. Can anyone speak to gender-specific programming and your opinions about having social and physical activities aimed directly at one gender?
The fitness connection program that we do in Langara tends to run as a women-only course.
Okay.
So we, with our workshops, we will tailor the workshops depending whether they're mixed gender or single gender. So we'll have like a gender roles in Canada, for example, and that is different depending on who the participants are.
Yeah.
We also have a parenting course that we bring into that fitness connection program for the Langara, the women's only. So yeah, we find that it just being aware and tailoring it to whoever is in the program works quite well.
Okay. Anyone else?
Anybody else?
I would just say I think that there's a need for both.
Yes.
Different circumstances. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just listening to the needs of your group.
Yeah, and that's also something too that we have the women's only program, and we did try it as a men's only program once, which we didn't have the interest in it, but we're talking of trying to do that again, because men have some things that they're probably more comfortable discussing with other
yes.
men as well. It's not only women only.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, I think we have time for one last question. Can the panel comment on the importance of intercultural competencies for staff and volunteers when leading social and physical activities? What sort of training is needed to ensure staff and volunteers are sensitive to differences in culture? Yeah, that is a good question.
Do you want to repeat it?
Sure, I can repeat it. Can the panel comment on the importance of intercultural competencies for staff and volunteers when leading social and physical activities? What sort of training is needed to ensure staff and volunteers are sensitive to differences in culture?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Any thoughts?
You know, from my perspective, I think that the education is important, and there is all sorts of training available. AMSSA, I don't know about the Safe Harbor program where it's at currently, but that's an example of a program, and there's different examples of cultural competency training that you can take that's more classroom-based. There's online training available, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
AMSSA offers fantastic e-symposiums and webinars you can participate in to broaden your intercultural understanding. But I still would say the practical component is just is so much more important, and actually getting to know people who are different from yourself is so much more valuable and important. So if your settlement team would have an opportunity to go and try activities that are culturally unfamiliar to you, as an example, or go and experience different activities and then have a debrief to analyze your experience and how inclusive was that activity and how could it be changed. And you know, if a woman wears a hijab, could she participate in this? What might be needed to shift that program so that woman would be more comfortable? If a person is transgender, how might they feel in this setting? What could be shifted? If someone has different mobility, mobility challenges, how could this program be shifted? So I guess it ties back to reflection as well. So yeah. I think a mix, doing training, I think is valuable. Lots of online training available, as well as in person. But get out there and get to know.
Learn by doing.
Right. Learn by doing.
One of the courses that I have taken that really beneficial from it is the Indigenous Cultural Competency course that is available online. But I like Kat echo, I think because the settlement workers, they are the expert in their field as well. So whenever there is a service or a program, I think should be referred to. When it comes to creating, finalizing the sports activity program or whatnot. I know it sounds like we're heavily relying on their expertise, but at the same time, because they know the participants group the most, and whenever, like you said, will there be any trigger points that might come out, or like I said, cultural sensitivity. So I know a couple of courses online, but I think. Like Kat mentions, the practical going through the services and programs itself and learning what you can take away.
And there is something that just comes to mind. I'm thinking of the use of critical incidents, and maybe the organizations that have this sort of programs might even kind of collect stories, critical incidents. They could be used for future training. Like I know I collect this, as a LINC instructor, stories, with conflicts happen because of misunderstanding, cultural misunderstanding, and then you can use that later as a teaching tool and a reflective tool for people. And there is one resource that I can think of now, and I'll try to give that to you later if people are interested.
Yeah, we'd appreciate that. Thank you.
And just echoing, I think creating scenarios during the training workshops with practical stories that are shared, of course, keeping it anonymous or whatnot, but creating scenarios that throughout the training workshop might also be a helpful tool.
Great. Thank you very much for all your input. Thank you, everybody, for all of your questions and input today. Thanks again to Michelle for sharing the case study with us and for being online. We really appreciate it. Wanting to let you know that the presentation will be available for you and your colleagues to view on the AMSSA website. We will send out a notification via SetNet once the recording is online. A special thank you to all our panelists and case study presenters for sharing their time and expertise with us today. And a big thank you to the AMSSA team for organizing today's event. A lot goes on behind the scenes. We will be emailing everyone an online evaluation form. Please take the time to fill this out, as AMSSA relies on the feedback provided in the evaluations to plan future events and trainings. And as a final note of thanks to Immigration, Refugees, and Citizenship Canada for funding this event today. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. See you next time.